Can we get progesterone and other hormones from yams? Well, that, my friend, is a $164,000 question. The answer is sorta. I'm Steve Goldring from simplehormones.com. I help patients and healthcare practitioners with easy to understand patient education resources. Most of those resources are about hormones and hormone optimization. In this video, we're going to take a look at hormones that are both synthetic, but also bioidentical. I'm going to make a bold statement that may upset some people, and some people may disagree with me. All bioidentical hormones are 100% synthetic. In 1943, the cost of progesterone was around $80 per gram. So just to put this in perspective, my wife takes progesterone. She takes a dosage of around 400 milligrams every single night. So if she were taking that same dosage in 1943, that would cost around $960 a month. By the way, that $960 was the cost to the manufacturer, not the price to the patient. If we really look at the price to the patient, that's going to be marked up maybe 5, maybe 10 times by the manufacturer. So instead of $960 a month, the actual price to my wife in 1943 would be between $4,800 and $9,600 a month. We've been hearing a whole lot about inflation in the U.S. economy over the past several months. So we really have to account for inflation in the last 80 years, because a dollar in 1943 had a lot more buying power than a dollar in 2022. When we account for inflation in today's dollars, my wife's progesterone would have cost us $78,787.90 at the low end, up to $164,426.91 at the high end every single month. My wife currently gets her progesterone for around $60 a month. Why is there such a vast discrepancy between those two prices? Just so we're clear, there are three ways that we can obtain hormones. The first is we can try to get those hormones directly from humans. Now, that seems to be logical. It makes a lot of sense. It would kind of assure us that we're getting actual human hormones. We could maybe take hormones from a person's thyroid gland or from their pancreas, or we could take it from their blood or from their urine or from their ovaries. We'd be assured that we're getting the same human hormones that we're trying to replace in someone else. But it doesn't take very long before we start to ask a few questions. Like, when we take hormones away from a human, what happens to them? They probably need those hormones, and for at least a time, they're going to be low on those hormones. What's the process of taking hormones from a human? How much is that going to cost? What are the implications of that from an ethical perspective? Option number two is to get hormones from animals. In fact, we've been doing that for over 100 years. Back in the 1890s, doctors started trying an extract of cow ovaries in women with menopause symptoms. And the thing is, it really worked. It was the first thing doctors tried that seemed to make a huge difference in menopause symptoms. Now, dried cow ovaries are a little bit of a primitive treatment for menopause, but in 1943, coincidentally, a new drug was approved by the FDA called Premarin. Premarin stands for pregnant mare's urine, and it is a set of hormones that comes directly from a natural source, animal urine. It's been in use continuously for the last 80 years, but it's kind of a dirty, messy combination of a lot of different hormones that come from horse urine. The kidneys are a filtration system, and that Premarin that comes out of the kidneys has as many as 10, maybe 17, possibly as many as 60 or more contaminants, many of which are hormones that are only found in horses. They're not the same as human hormones, which is that problem that we get when we use animal hormones. They could be contaminated with other things that we don't really know what they're going to cause, either good or bad. The third way we can create hormones is through chemical synthesis. We'll end up with a synthetic hormone, a hormone that is not created through some natural process, but it's a man-made, chemically synthesized hormone. While it sounds like a word that nobody wants, synthetic, I would contend that chemical synthesis is the cleanest and most economically viable way to get hormones. Now, you'll notice that I don't have a number four that says get hormones from plants. And the reason for that is the total number of plants that produce human hormones is zero. That's because plants do not have the biochemical ability or the chemical machinery to make human hormones. Period. Plants do not make any hormones that are the same as human hormones. Enter Russell Earl Marker. Russell Marker was a chemistry professor at Pennsylvania State College, which later became Penn State University. Marker was very interested in a number of plants, especially different types of yams around the world, that had high levels of a chemical in them called sapogenins. Now, sapogenins, there was one particular sapogenin that's called diosgenin that Marker was very interested in. And he thought that there might be a way that he could extract diosgenin from certain types of yams and be able to make hormones out of that diosgenin. Well, of the various plants and yams that Marker tried, he came across one in Mexico called a Mexican wild yam. I took a trip to my local Mexican market the other day to take a look at some yams that I had seen in the produce department. Those yams were huge. Now, the kind of yams that Marker was interested in Mexico are not the same as the ones you serve at Thanksgiving. If you tried to serve these yams up at your Thanksgiving dinner, your guests would probably first spit out those yams because they're terribly bitter. Second, your guests might excuse themselves to the bathroom and start violently vomiting because Mexican wild yams are completely inedible. But those yams are chosen for their high level of diosgenin. Remember, diosgenin is not a human hormone. Yams do not contain human hormones. But Russell Marker was, after a couple of years of experimentation in his lab, able to come up with a synthetic chemical process that transformed the diosgenin from those Mexican wild yams into progesterone. That process ended up getting the name the Marker Degradation. Now, here's a diagram of what that looks like to a chemist. On the upper left, it shows the chemical structure of diosgenin, which goes through a five-step process using several chemical helpers. In chemistry, they're referred to as catalysts. Those chemical helpers encourage those reactions to move along in that chemical synthesis process until eventually in the lower left corner you get progesterone. Now that progesterone can go through some further steps to become estradiol, testosterone, DHEA, pregnenolone, and other hormones. If you don't understand what's going on in that chemical diagram, that's okay. Don't even worry about it. Just know that this chemical synthesis process is extremely important in the manufacture of bioidentical hormones, hormones that are exactly the same as human hormones. In addition to bioidentical hormones like estradiol and progesterone, the Marker degradation has been used to create lots of other hormones, including hormones that transformed the sexual revolution in the 1960s, birth control pills. Without Russell Marker and the Marker degradation, birth control as we know it today might not exist. I would contend that to this day, the only economically viable way to produce bioidentical hormones is through the Marker degradation, a chemical synthesis process. Well, the Marker degradation has been refined and expanded and adjusted over the last 80 years, but it still is in use today. And we still obtain progesterone, estradiol, testosterone, and lots of other bioidentical and non-bioidentical hormones using this chemical synthesis process. Bioidentical hormones are synthesized from the diosgenin we find in yams, as well as from other sapogenins that we find in soy and other plants. So the answer to the $164,000 question, can we get progesterone from yams, is, well, no, not directly. But we can get something called diosgenin, which can be converted in a chemical synthesis process called the marker degradation into progesterone. That way we can get synthetic bioidentical hormones that aren't contaminated with a lot of other stuff that we don't want. If this video has been helpful at all, click the like and subscribe buttons, and you might want to click the little bell to get notified anytime I post a new video. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll look forward to talking to you again real soon.